one seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere filling the air. Oh, how they come raising the sound. Oh, hill and dale, dale and dale, giving their rain.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Bernard Brogan, and welcome back to 12 Days of a Christmas Carol. Last night, the ghost of Christmas Past brought Scrooge to the home of the Cratchits and told him of a bleak destiny of Tiny Tim if the shadows remained unaltered by the future. Can Scrooge save Tiny Tim? Let's read on and see what happens. By and by, they had a song from Tiny Tim, who had a plaintive little voice and sang it very well indeed. They were not a handsome family. They were not well dressed, but they were happy, grateful, pleased with one another, and contented with their time. In the bright sprinklings of the spirit's torch at parting, Scrooge had his eye upon them, and especially on Tiny Tim until the last. By this time it was getting darker and snowing pretty heavily as Scrooge and the spirit went along the streets. And now, without a word of warning from the ghost, they stood upon a bleak and desert moor. "What place is this?" asked Scrooge. "A place where miners live, who labour in the bowels of the earth," returned the spirit. "But they know me, see?" Passing through the wall of mud and stone, they found an old, old man and woman, with their children and their children's children, all decked out gaily in their holiday attire. The old man was singing a Christmas song, and from time to time they all joined in the chorus. Again the ghost sped on, above the black and heaving sea, on and on, until being far away from any shore, they lighted on a ship. They stood beside the helmsman, the lookout, the officers on watch. Every man among them hummed a Christmas tune, or had a Christmas thought. And every man on board, waking or sleeping, good or bad, had a kinder word for another on that day, more than any other day of the year. It was a great surprise to Scrooge, while listening to the moanings of the wind, to hear a hearty laugh, and to recognise as his own nephews. He found himself in a bright, gleaming room, with the spirit standing smiling by his side. "Ha ha," laughed Scrooge's nephew. "He said that Christmas was a humbug. As I live, he believed it too." "More shame for him, Fred," said Scrooge's niece indignantly. "He's a comical old fellow," said Scrooge's nephew. "That's the truth, and not so pleasant as might be. However, the offences carried their own punishment, and I am sorry for him. I couldn't be angry with him if I tried. Who suffers by his ill whims, himself always." After tea, they had some music and played at games. For it's good to be children sometimes, and never better than at Christmas. There might have been 20 people there, young and old, but they all played and sang. And so did Scrooge, forgetting that his voice made no sound in their ears. He sometimes came out with his singing quite loud. The ghost was greatly pleased to see him in this mood, and looked upon him with such favour that he begged like a boy to be allowed to stay until the guests departed. But this, the spirit said, could not be done. Much they saw, and far they went, and everywhere the spirit went, he left his blessings. It was a long night, and Scrooge noticed that the ghost grew older, clearly older, and he noticed that its hair was grey. "Are spirits' lives so short?" asked Scrooge. "My life upon this globe is very brief," replied the ghost. "It ends tonight at midnight. Hark, that time is drawing near." The bell struck 12 and the spirit disappeared. As the last stroke ceased to vibrate, he remembered the prediction of old Jacob Marley, and lifting up his eyes, beheld a solemn phantom, draped and hooded, coming like a mist along the ground towards him. Join us tomorrow at the same time to hear what's next for Scrooge. Thank you and good night.
Star lights up way up high, and the walls of doubt crumble, tossed and torn. This comes to pass when a child is born.